I don't even talk about emancipation these days. I talk about emancipations and liberations. I don't think that we can have just a general model of emancipation. That was, again, another way of distancing myself of the Western-centering conceptions of Marxism. I think there are different ways of liberating. I think that, for instance, the concept of dignity has been a very good concept to put us together in many international groups of social of social movements that resist against, you know, they don't speak about socialism. Indigenous people never talk about socialism. They don't also talk about peasants don't like talking about human rights. But dignity is a very important concept. It's important in the West because, in fact, human rights is a narrative of dignity, quite frankly. Dignity appears in the Quran very often. And dignity is a key concept of the indigenous cosmovisions. So it's alternative ways of looking at this. So resistance is the movement toward emancipation or emancipations. The problem in our time, Upen, is that we know much better what we don't know than what we want to know. That is to say, we know that we refuse a society based on concentration of wealth, on the destruction of nature as it is now. But we don't know very well the blueprint of another society. And that's why it's so easy for the conservatives to say that there is an alternative. Because in fact, the critical thinker has not been providing an alternative view of society, I have to confess that. And that's why the World Social Forum is another world is possible, but does not define that world, right? Well, the question of social regulation, As it is defined in my work, in this, there are different conceptions of cause of social regulation. It is always, in modernity for me, is a way in which you create, through an institutionalized way, modes of conviviality through institutions and rules, which are basically agreed upon by some kind of legitimacy. That is to say, social regulation for me is based on the state legitimacy of modernity. Here's a very barbarian concept. Of course, there are many other regulations these days, but the one that I apply is the one that combines the principle of the market, the principle of the state, and the principle of the community, but under the aegis of the state. I think modern regulation has been basically a state regulation. Now probably we are going away from that paradigm. That's transnational law and all the things that we have been discussing. But I have seen that. So this social regulation is based on the idea of legitimacy to develop regulation. That is to say, if I'm not satisfied with this regulation, I'm entitled to struggle for a better one. Women, peasants, you know, landless urban dwellers, and so on. So they have basic rights, and they struggle for better rights, for better society. The problem is when people are not entitled to enter this game, because they are on the other side of the line. So, and that's precisely there. There is, of course, a regulation. I mean, concentration camps in Denmark or in Italy, well, they are regulated, of course. I visit some of them. Some of are quite even good, I would say, except that people cannot leave those places, and they stay there for years.
You know what the name was in Italy? It was centers of temporary permanence.
Yeah, and that temporary permanence, that's precisely. So, I think, Marisa, you raise a very important question also, as all the others. That is to say, how we are going to struggle for liberation on the other side of the line? Well, we have an experience. I mean, the national liberation movements that fought against colonialism. In fact, no colonial state, in fact, gave away colonialism by just an act of will. They were pressed by struggles. They were pressed by movements, they were pressed, you know, by any kind of thing. So there are, of course, pressures to bring about liberation of this other side of the line. What kind of instruments are they, could they use? Well, there was a time in which was armed struggle. I don't think that armed struggle, I'm a pacifist, so I don't think that armed struggle, in my view, is a good way of overcoming the colonialism, because what is crucial for me today is colonialism does not, goes always together with colonialism, capitalism goes together with colonialism and patriarchy. The three forms of domination are one. And the problems with social movements is that some of the movements fight against capitalism, others against colonialism, and others against patriarchy. And they never get united. And the three work together. That's the basic. Can law be operative there? I think law operates much better on this side of the line than on the other side of the line. So we need a more intensified politicization of the struggles to create visibility of these people. Not just, you know, to help them, because I believe in solidarity, but Gayatri Spivak, as can the subaltern speak? Well, I think they have a voice. We don't hear it, because our scientific knowledge is not trained for deep listening. We don't know how to listen deeply to the other. If it is not intelligible to us, that's why in the epistemologies of the South, intercultural translation is so important. Why in many movements we have been trying to make translation? We have to start to eliminate the prejudices. Then we have to find ways of translating among different groups. You know, in my experience, what has worked very well? Territory for indigenous people, the body as territory for the women. The women know very well the body as a territory because they suffered in that territory. So you can have a kind of an intercultural translation between territory as land with territory as body. Women understand, probably men not so well, but women understand this struggle very well. So here a good example of intercultural translation among two conceptions of territory, two materialities. So I think that law is violence. Well, law has always been violence, as I said this morning. Law has these three structural elements, rhetoric, violence, and bureaucracy. The problem is the violence that you attach to law is legitimate violence. I mean, it's Weber. What does he say? Basically, Weber says that law is legitimate violence. And that's why we have no discomfort with enforcement policies, with police and so on. We are discomfort when, in fact, they are going beyond the law. The problem is today is that legitimate violence goes together with illegitimate violence. And sometimes don't pay attention to that. On the contrary, we forget about that. Guantanamo, is it legitimate violence? Is it legal or illegal? Is beyond legal and illegal, is illegal, I would say. The southern border of the United States, dividing the United States from the Latinos when so many people have been killed. The wall is an abyssal wall, but a cement wall that separates the Sahrawi people from Morocco. The wall that separates Palestinians from Israel. They are abyssal lines. They are zones of non-being on the other side. That's what I think that I'm a clash. And in fact, I don't have time for the last questions, but I will continue after lunch. Thank you. I'm part of a generation of sociolegal scholars, very distinguished and very innovative scholars. And I think that is Peter genius to bring them together here. Three of them are here: William Twining, Sally Mary, and Pedro Baxi. Any of them could have their books also here. And I think that that's my recommendation to Pierre for the next editions of the summer school. He does anatomies with the books of these remarkable colleagues with whom I have shared so many things over my life. So it's very important that we have a sense of community and the collective. If one of us, you know, becomes more visible for some reason, I think we should bring along all the others. That's what I do with social movements. Women's movement come along more visible, bring along with you the peasants and the gays and the indigenous people. I mean, we have to do that in our lives almost every day. So to the questions and some of comments I'd like to make. I think that there are several, but I'll be very brief. First of all, what I've noticed in terms of resistance today is that for many of us who have been engaging with social movements, organizations, and so on, and what I have experienced in my life is that the youth is not coming, it's not joining the social movements. The social movements are getting older and older in many countries. Mm-hmm. Where are the youth? Well, are they just depoliticized? Well, they are in the Occupy movement, they are in the Indignados movement, they are doing something else. So in my work I've been, and it's part of a piece that's already done and published, or is being published, is that I really think that beyond social movements and beyond parties and beyond the other organizations, we need to bring new categories. And these categories, collective presences. People that take to the streets, because the streets are the only places, public spheres, that have not been colonized by the financial markets. And therefore, people take that. What does that mean? That we are in a post-institutional democracy. They say we have democracy, we have parties, we have institutions, but some of them are not performing what they should be performing. So people are becoming more distant. So I think that one note is on the forms of institutional and non-institutional resistance. Why so many people are taking to the streets? And why protest is being criminalized? That's one point. The second one is that many of the youth with which I work, they really don't like logocentric discussions like this, but they like music. They write, the best protest literature I know is hip-hop these days, are the rappers. And I even wrote lyrics for rappers. And some of them, if you go to YouTube, you can see Boaventura and rap, and they'll show that I'm presenting a show of rappers, young Afro-descendants from Brazil, from the ghettos. They were in the drugs. They were really at the end of their lives. And then music rescued them. It was not social movements. It's not our rhetoric, but music. Protest music, rap, and hip-hop. Our theories, that's why, and Barreto showed that very well, that's why I moved more and more to aesthetics and to art and literature and so on. I'm not going into that, why I'll do this, but I can see that many people are resisting to the idea. It's very Western, very modern, that art is magnificent, but it's outside world, it's the aura, as Walter Benjamin described it. It's not serious. Poets are marvelous, but they are crazy. So they are not part of our society, they're not serious. Well, literature and art is very serious in our world, and I see that in many contexts, we have to pay more attention to literature, to the arts, to the public arts, to the performance of the selves in our societies. Third question, on questions of Western-centric or Eurocentric human rights. Mariam, I really enjoyed your presentation. I enjoyed all the presentations. Thank you so much. We're fabulous. You know, when I learned the questions, my first engagement with intercultural human rights, you have to see the context in which our theories developed. It was when I was with Islamic women preparing for the Vienna conference and for the Beijing conference on the rights of women. And these women were part of a movement, Islamic Reformation, in which Abdul Ahmed and Naim, a good friend of ours, who is in the United States, we were discussing the ways in which you could really develop a theory of human rights and dignity without leaving Islam. Because Islam is as diversified as Catholicism, Protestantism, and so on. So the idea is that we want to bring the equality of rights to women, and they interpret the Quran, of course, in such a way that you can see that the equality is there. It's a question of reading and interpretation. But they didn't want to leave Islamic culture. They want to do that inside their own culture. This was a fabulous lesson for me. Because I was coming with the prejudice that Islam is the hard case, in Dworkin's case. It's the hard case for women. It was not for them. Then 2 years ago, we were organizing dual social forum in Tunis, the first forum there. And we were discussing what would be the topic of the World Social Forum. And because our colleagues who were in the Arab Spring, and probably Tunisia was the most successful, of course the jihadists are trying to destroy this, but they were really very successful, and the role of women in Tunisia is absolutely crucial to understand the success of this transition. We discovered, well, the topic will be human rights. Our friends from Maghreb, from the social movements in Maghreb, Algeria, Morocco, and said, no, human rights is not a good narrative to describe us. And many people in movements that, I'm not talking about, Davos and World Economic Forum, there were social movements for other continents, they didn't understand the resistance. But if you could go back the history, and I had the privilege of having done that, I could understand that. Because when Napoleon invaded Egypt, when he arrived in Alexandria in 1798, you should read, I mean, Pierre, please, next year, put the proclamation of Napoleon in this summer school, because it's a fabulous proclamation. He comes there and says, well, they are saying that you are invading you, that you are destroying your structures of power, the Mamelukes, as they were called. No, we are bringing you the human rights. That's what is in the proclamation. And there is, and in this book, If God Were a Human Rights Activist, I have a note on Hagarbarti, who is a chronicle from Alexandria, an Islamic one, an Egyptian one, looking at the battleships from Napoleon and said, is this guy crazy? What is he doing? He's bringing us, he's invading us and saying that he's bringing us human rights. So two narratives. So I could understand why they resisted. Then we went on talking, discussing, and then we came up with a common ground for the World Social Forum. And that was a marvelous exercise in intercultural translation, was dignity. And that's why the topic was dignity and not human rights, because of the reasons, as I said. But there were other reasons. Have you never thought, probably in this summer school you are going to think about that, why do we talk about human rights and not about human duties? There are other cultures that talk more about duties than rights. Aren't we a little bit disturbed by the fact that the suicide bombers are considered martyrs in their communities, their families are honored and protected by the whole community? It's disturbing. Because martyrs, we know them in the Catholic Church, in Christianity, but in the second century, when they were a position before Constantine, there were lots of martyrs that did the suicide bombers of the time. San Sebastian, for this is a good martyr from this. So later case. We don't know how to deal with these issues, but at least we should address them in order to come up with, I consider myself an activist of human rights. I've always been so, and I know why. I lived in a dictatorship in Portugal until 74. So I know that civil and political rights are not trivial. Because when I arrived from Yale to do my first class in Coimbra, it was the end of the regime, It was a new school they were creating and they invited me. I was coming from law school, I moved to the School of Economics. And I knew that in my class, that row over there, they were the police informants. I knew them, they were students. We had grants from the secret police that were there to really do some control of what we were saying. And one thing that I was saying, so for you to see a context, because you are so young, you don't see how these democratic rights are so difficult to conquer sometimes, is that the things that I was doing is something that I had learned with all my professors in sociology at Yale. It was very simple. Who are the founders of sociology? Durkheim, Max Weber, and Marx. My contribution is to add Ibn Khaldun, right? Marx. But I couldn't pronounce the name Marx in my classes in Portugal at the time. So what I did was to speak about Marx, translate his name into a Portuguese name, Carlos Marx, which is the Portuguese translation of Karl Marx, so that they wouldn't understand whom I was talking about, because they were really ignorant. So I was talking about another person called Carlos Marx. And the books that they could buy, they would go to the bookstore, and it was underneath the owner of the bookstore would have the books for the students, because they were my students, they were reliable people, so they would not denounce this guy to the police, because if they would denounce him, they would close down the bookshop. That was November 1973. April 74 was the revolution. So let's have a little bit of context on this. Another idea which I'd like to discuss, mention to you, invisibility. I was discussing with Ucha about invisibility because, you know, sociology of absences and so on, came up very, very clear in our discussion. I think it's very important to have, if you're doing empirical work and so on, you have to make two very important points in your research. First of all, there are people that want to be invisible. Invisibility as an act of will is the very different from the invisibility as an act of oppression. It's the same with silence. If I want to be silenced, it's fine. If I'm silenced, it's not fine. In the rituals, in many religions, the most powerful person is the one that never talks. In fact, in Christianity, God never talks. That's why he's so powerful. So silence is a source of power, and silence is a source of powerlessness. So you have to distinguish the situation. But Usha, which I'd like to discuss with her, brought another question. When, even if people are silenced, made invisible, as we were discussing in the previous session, then when they are made visible, they are made visible according to hegemonic categories. They are made visible as women, as indigenous people, as peasants. And no matter how, what category you use, you make another category invisible. That's why many women that get liberated in these struggles, but as women, not as indigenous people, so the question of land is not raised. So you create, through visibility, you create invisibility, you see? And you have to have this hermeneutics of suspicion to any categories. Because absolute transparency is the panopticum of Bentham. You never have absolute knowledge. But we have to be, in fact, what a great philosopher from the 14th century called us upon to be, a German philosopher, Nicholas of Cusa. We have to be learned ignorant. Not ignorant ignorant. We have to ignore, we have to be learned ignorant to know the limits of our knowledges. And therefore be able to entertain other knowledges. Because if a culture is complete, why should that culture enter in an intercultural dialogue? I have all the solutions for everything. Only completeness could be a motivation for intercultural dialogue. Why the final one, and Marisa raised that? Who decides, the colleague there, who decides emancipation? That's precisely one of the most important points, and particularly, as I said, with now regulation, emancipation, it's true that I'm probably trapped into the dualities. Now, well, I'm trapped in language. We cannot think the new except through the old, because language in itself is old when you're trying, and if you apply, many neologisms, nobody understands you. And if you want to be absolutely clear, you are into the Wittgenstein trap. If you can say it clearly, just shut up. So that's what Wittgenstein did at the end of the life. He ended not crazy, but silent, because he couldn't say anything clearly. So I think that we have seen the limits of this. But the point is that it was very easy when we had a meta-narrative that society goes from capitalism to socialism and communism and so on. It has been all along. I mean, before with the bourgeoisie. I mean, the bourgeoisie was a revolutionary class, always struggling for a better society, for a more developed, the technological development. If you look, everything happens in the 19th century. Look at as the Ottoman Empire is looking at the West. Only in the late 19th century, they think that the West is something serious. Can you imagine that the first reports on the Ottoman Empire over the discoveries, the Portuguese and the Spanish discoveries, came out in the 19th century. Up until then, the Ottoman Empire could not really face to the reality that there are seaborne empires, because the empire for the Ottoman Empire was hinterland, was land. So these questions have to be addressed in order to understand why today, if you don't have a kind of a linear history, and really today, the realities of our world, what happens in Southern Europe today, where I come from, and I'm working closely with the movements in Greece, with Syriza, with Podemos in Spain, with leftist bloc in Portugal, and we are working together to find an alternative to the IMF. Well, my theories are grounded in my realities also, and probably maybe not your realities. Why am, for me, I'm at this point bringing so clearly, of course it was my decolonial, post-colonial, as Barreto did so well, a turn to see the questions of appropriation and violence. We can discuss what that is, but that's another question. Why is that so important? Because Europe was applying the IMF rules to the world, thinking they were the best rules in the world. I mean, structural adjustment, which many countries have suffered, If these policies were happening there, there would be no problem. The problem is now they are come home to roost. And therefore now they are horrible. Why didn't you see that? Why didn't you see that the comforts of social democracy were really created upon the misery of millions of people in the colonies? Why didn't you see that? We even saw that colonialism was a progressive move. So I think that now we have to address this question of the emancipation. No, nobody can say what is emancipation, first of all. I think emancipation are the people in struggle. And there are different conceptions, of course. And here you are going to tell me, but you know, the jihadists are not a social movement. Are they for emancipation? Well, that's a debate. Probably they think they are. Why do we think that they are not? Because you are not relativists. I think for me, emancipation is an inclusive inclusion, which is a kind of a progressive, not the idea of progress, but a progressive inclusion under new conditions posed by the included. The problem in Western modernity is that we include, for instance, indigenous peoples, but as individuals. But indigenous people want to be included as collectives. That's why all the struggles about collective rights. So the conditions of inclusion change as people are included, and this is the difficult thing for us to do. So emancipation cannot be, there is no central committee to tell you what emancipation is. There are different ways of going around. There are, you know, movements. I know that, and you have to decide which side are you on. It's your responsibility, because nobody can tell you that you are right. You have to discuss it with others, and you have to take risks. For instance, are you on the right of peasants or on the right of Monsanto? For transgenic food or for Creole seeds? That's one of the struggles in which we are involved now. With Via Campesina fighting for the seeds, the peasant seeds, and the Monsanto fight for transgenic seeds. Not just in the third world, but now in Europe. They have just changed the regulation. And we are going to have transgenic food here in Europe, particularly with the Transatlantic Partnership. Which side are we on? So we have to discuss, this is not an abstract question, is that there are people that are on the side of Monsanto and people that are on the side of peasants. For me, it's a question of power. And I tend to be on the side of those that have been oppressed by more powerful forces. It's a political option. So that's my answer to knowledge and politics. There is no knowledge that is no politics. From the very beginning, When Descartes came up with that distinction between body and soul, everybody accepts this distinction today for us, body and soul. Spinoza said, almost you know, a few years later, because he was almost contemporary of Descartes, and Spinoza said, it's the most stupid distinction that you can imagine, distinction between body and soul. Because this is going to lead to a politics that those that control the body control the politics. So knowledge, politics. What happened is then we created this form of knowledge that was so powerful that became itself so powerful that can decide the terms of autonomy. It's like law. Law becomes autonomous at the moment in which it becomes dependent on the state, but we don't see that. Law was much more autonomous in sociological terms, because different groups have different regions have different laws. So with science is the same. Science becomes so important that can decide that we are autonomous, free knowledge, and we are neutral and value neutral. Well, as you know, all Sandra Harding, Donna Haraway, the feminist epistemologists, they have debunked that more than anybody else. So we know that epistemology is also about politics. And the epistemology of the South is, of course, about politics. So these were some of the things that I'd like to share with you, and it has been a fabulous day for me of interaction. I want to see all these papers, and they have so many important issues for my, you know, I don't have the age to write many more books, but in any case, there are so many issues here that I definitely have a lot of work to do. Thank you so much.